Dueling Genre Productions presents Immunities, an audio drama.
What a beautiful night.
Yes, it is.
Did you see that?
See what?
A light. It's gone now.
Are you okay?
I'm feeling a little drowsy. I better sit down.
Here, let me help you.
About 5 months ago, there was something in the night sky. Something happened to the people who saw it. And if someone looked them in the eyes, it would happen to them too.
How are you feeling?
I am feeling much better. I thank you for asking. And you yourself, how are you feeling?
Oh, I'm fine. I was fine. I feel a little unsteady now.
I suggest having a rest. It did me a world of good.
They looked at their families, and then they searched out friends, strangers, everybody. Some people didn't change. We think maybe one person out of 2,000.
So, for 5 months, you've just been hanging out?
Shelley, I don't know what this is. I've never seen anyone just become normal again. I have to be careful. You might just change back into one of them. You might be one of them now.
This is too complicated. I'm too tired to deal with it. And I'm still half expecting you to tell me it's all just a story.
It isn't!
I just know I have to close my eyes now.
Wait, Shelley? No, Shelley? Shelley?
Don't worry.
Shelley?
It's just for a second.
Shelley!
Immunities, an audio drama about almost everyone being against you. Available from duelinggenre.com and your podcatcher of choice, starting in July.
Dueling Genre.
Welcome back to Rocky Minute, the daily podcast where we analyze the movie Rocky one exciting minute at a time. I'm Doug Greenberg.
And I'm Jason Hayes.
And joining us again from the Yo Rocky Philly...
Man.
I'm gonna get this right one.
You get this right by Friday?
Yo Philly Rocky Film Tour. Philadelphia's own Mike Kunda. Mike, welcome.
Yo, guys, it's so good to be back. I've missed you. It was a crazy 24 hours.
Same here. Today we're knocking out minute 32, which begins with Paulo correcting Jurgens. And it ends with Buddy's political incorrectness. So yesterday, Jurgens, he says his Apollo's plan is very American, and Apollo corrects him by saying, no, it's very smart. Who can argue with him?
Nobody. I mean, it's we see here why Apollo Creed is the master at what he does. Not only is he the champion of the ring, but he's the champion of marketing.
There's kind of a weird moment after as they're shaking hands. They're shaking hands very emphatically, by the way. it's kind of like almost a sinister,
like
sort
a
of
maniacal,
laugh.
Like evil, like evil empire laugh type of thing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is this supposed to?
And it carries on for too long. Like almost something out of like the Austin Powers.
All right.
Like, Dr. Evil.
That's a Thayer David, like typical moment. Thayer David, who plays, George Jurgens, or Miles Jurgens, as we mentioned, he was a bad guy in most movies. He's always the bad guy in the movies from the 60s and 70s.
He has both the look and the voice, and obviously the laugh of a bad
guy.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Covering it the way we're analyzing it in these one-minute clips, if you were to pause the movie right there and kind of just think about how this could possibly play out. It seems like Apollo Creed is a bad guy here, right? It's like a complete self-serving mission that he's on.
I wouldn't disagree with that. You know, we've seen up to this point the squalor that Rocky lives in. You know, it looks like Rocky's apartment, someone took a garbage can and just littered his apartment with it. And when you go out into the streets of Kensington where they filmed Rocky, it looks like someone took a giant dumpster and emptied it onto the street. So Rafe already we feel for Rocky, right? He's talking to turtles. He's tapping on the window of the pet shop earlier in the movie to the puppies and talking to Butkus, whatever. Well, you know, now we see Apollo. We're like, geez, you don't have to be so pompous. And he did an amazing job of selling it. Carl Weathers did an amazing job of selling it very quickly in a very short amount of time.
Did he ever? It kind of poses a question that when he's looking through the book of names, trying to pick guys out, I was asking myself through these minutes, is what Apollo's doing selfish, or is he showing a benevolent side?
I would just go. Apollo's ego is at work here. We're gonna point to Apollo's ego very shortly, but I don't know. You bring up a good point, actually. There may be a benevolent side to Apollo by giving a local Philadelphia boy, a Snow White underdog, a chance. So maybe there's a little redemption, which comes into play later in the series, I suppose.
I'm not sure that I agree so much. I don't think what he's doing is that maniacal. I mean, they went through the contenders. I mean, it wasn't like this was the first choice. Like, he tried to get a contender. He was fighting a contender, but it didn't work out. Nobody else was available. So they had to come up with another idea, and he comes up with, let's give this guy a shot. I could see the ego at play a little bit because, as we're going to learn later, he doesn't care about anything but the name. He's looking for that novelty name that's going to draw people in, that's going to make people watch, it's going to bring in the money, bring in the whatever you bring in the 70s in boxing. But I don't think he's as I don't want to use the word maniacal again.
Sinister?
But I don't think he's as sinister as you're making him out to be at this moment yet.
We were just going.
He's definitely has a he's arrogant. He's got an ego problem, but that's the
well. Would you, would you agree that he's more businesslike instead of champion-like?
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely.
In this scene, he's absolutely more businesslike. Absolutely, 100%.
Okay, I think I would agree with you guys on that.
Okay, see that? Come to a happy medium. Here we go. All right, so we leave Jurgen's office for the time being. We cut to a downtown Philly street. What street is that?
It's actually called Tusculum Street.
Tusculum Street.
Tusculum.
Tusculum. Oh, shit. I've been saying it wrong this whole time.
Well, no. Actually, don't be too hard on yourself because people in Philly that live in Kensington, which is northeast Philadelphia, that's where they filmed it, some people refer to it as Tusculum, Tusculum. It just depends on where you live, because I say it right sometimes and I say it wrong sometimes, but the name of the street is Tusculum.
See, us on the east coast of New Jersey called Tusculum, so
definitely not Tusculum. Those people should be flogged and hit. Block them from Twitter if they're calling it Tusculum.
That's what I've been calling it since minute one. So,
oh, okay, goodbye.
I'll flog my All right, we got a nice little snowy moment right here. It's snowing.
That's one of the reasons why there are many reasons why Rocky came together, but one of the main reasons, I believe, was the weather. You know, the producers wanted to film this all in California, and there's no way you would have had the same gritty effect as you would in Philadelphia. We see the snow. We see the breath coming out of their mouths. To me, with the overcast skies, this is something that plays into the whole Rocky mythology for me. It's something that I am very aware of when I watch it. It was filmed on the East Coast somewhere. There's no doubt. As a matter of fact, they were there. They were only in Philadelphia for 5 days, starting at 4:35 in the morning on December 5th in 1975. And everyone knows the story. They ran around guerrilla filmmaking. They didn't pay the union, whatever. And it was literally one shot. Is all they had on most scenes. Avildsen would tell them, "Oh, you know, here, look, this looks like a good corner. Get out, say your lines, get back in the van, let's go." And that's basically the premise of how they did it.
We have talked before about how Philadelphia is pretty much like another character in the movie. You know, it gives
totally.
And, you know, we have said many times that you know, this movie, it could have worked in New York City. It could have worked maybe in Boston, but this wouldn't have worked in Miami or, you know, Los Angeles, like you said, or Santa Fe, New Mexico. It just would have had the same.
Could you imagine if Rocky, you're so
wearing shorts right now.
could you imagine like if Rocky was filmed in like Oklahoma or Poughkeepsie or they like Denver, you know, it's like, my God, or, you know, like are in Seattle. I just don't think it would have the same look or feel.
Maybe Chicago I would throw in there. Chicago, New York, Boston, Philly. Pretty much are the only places I think this would have worked.
They have to have an elevated train. That's the main – they need the L train.
A car that's too nice for this neighborhood, Gazzo's 1973 Cadillac DeVille, drives up the street, Tusculum Street.
Yes.
All right, let me stop you right there.
Go for it.
I just learned something new. Mm-hmm. 73 Cadillac DeVille. I never knew that.
That was on the IMDb car database.
Really? Cadillac DeVille. Mm-hmm. I'm writing that down as I speak. I never knew that.
Look at that. I'm the guy who's seen the movie hundreds of times. Still learning.
I love it. This is why I love social media. Because just when you think you're the biggest, the fastest, the strongest, here comes Paul Bunyan who takes you out with his axe and his big blue ox and someone knows more. I love this.
Well, so he parks in front of Rocky's house, right?
Mm-hmm, totally.
That's Rocky's house there on the left.
It sure is. 1818 Tusculum.
And does it look like? Does it look the same today as it did in this movie?
It looks identical. The only thing that's changed, they got new windows, a new front door, and the 1818 has never been painted over. It's so faded, but it's still there. We actually created. I came up with this line of T-shirts that I sell. And it's a little bit of brick facing on a black T-shirt with the 1818 painted on it, just as it was in the movie.
Oh, my God. I love that idea.
And on the back, it says, all I want to do is go the distance, which is obviously what Rocky says the night before the fight inside 1818 Tusculum. And so anyways, we sell these T-shirts, and they've been flying off our shelves here. And by shelves... By shelves, I mean the back of my tour van.
Well, you're going to have to let our fans know where to get those.
They can email me at mkunda33@comcast.net, and I'll get them out to them.
I'm going to need one of those.
We'll get them out to you.
Excellent. So Rocky gets out of the back seat of Gazzo's car, and he starts to walk away, but you know he doubles back, knocks on the window. Just making sure he's got, you know, his I's dotted and his T's crossed.
Which he doesn't. He's completely wrong.
He couldn't be more wrong. Rocky, yes, he says he needs to pick up 2 yards from Snyder and a grand from Capoli. And Gazzo corrects him that it's 2 yards from Capoli and a grand from Snyder. Now, I was wondering what a yard is. Were you wondering that? Did you find it?
I believe a yard is marijuana.
Oh, is it?
I believe so. See, everybody forgets this, and the other one is cocaine. See, a lot of people a gram of cocaine, a yard of marijuana.
Oh, a gram. I thought he said a grand.
No, gram.
Oh.
Gram. See, here's the thing that everyone forgets. Rocky was a drug runner. He was a drug mule. Nobody ever remembers this. Whenever we're talking about Rocky, and I talk to – in my life, this is no exaggeration, I've talked to thousands and thousands of people. Nobody ever brings up the fact that Rocky ran drugs for Gazzo. But the thing was, this is what Rocky had to do to get a couple of bucks to survive because his boxing career wasn't going anywhere. He only made it to ninth grade, as we would find out later in the series. So, you know, Rocky was not so pure. And I'm not quite sure where the inspiration came from that. Possibly from Chuck Wepner. Chuck Wepner had been involved with drugs a little bit, and Chuck was actually a collector for the New Jersey mob. That was a real thing. And, you know, Sloan drew a certain amount of, inspiration from that. How much? Hard to say.
Yeah, I was thinking that a grand back in 1975. See, we just thought it was Gazzo was a loan shark. He loaned money, and, you know, he charged a high vig and sent Rocky to collect. I didn't realize that drugs were part of the operation, which makes sense.
Sure.
If you're a mobster, you know, and, Wow, 2 yards from Coppola, because Duke needs that weed.
Yeah, he does. He does.
When I thought it was they were talking in currency terms, I looked up what yard was.
Yeah.
And one thing I found was yard was slang for 1 billion currency units. I said, no.
That ain't it.
That is incorrect. But on Wikipedia, they call a $50 bill is referred to by some as half a yard. So if he was getting 2 yards from Capoli, that would be $200, which makes more sense.
Which is true.
Yeah, look at that.
But a gram of coke, what is it? A gram and 2 yards of cocaine, of marijuana. That's an interesting twist.
How much is a yard of marijuana? Yeah, on Urban Dictionary, it confirms that a yard or does refer to marijuana, but it doesn't say
how much it is.
How much.
If you guys want to hang on a second, let me give Stallone a call, and I will see what his thought process was. Because there's only a few people. I've probably, you know, on the tours, nobody's really talked about that. But, you know, I've met some really hardcore people who are big Rocky fans, and they were like, hey, you know, Rocky was a, you know, carried drugs for Gazzo. And I was always like, I thought he was a loan shark. I said, well, you know, they did a little bit of everything back in the day. I was like, oh, that's very interesting. And the more I started listening to it, I was like, okay, a gram and yards. That is very interesting. So you fellas bring up some very good controversial statements here. I'm loving this.
Only seeing it minute by minute can you pick these things up. You know? But how about Rocky's glasses and his damn notebook?
That's beautiful. He can't remember anything, and he writes it down, and it's wrong. How do you spell Del Rio?
Yeah, that's the other one.
Looking up in a dictionary, Rock. Come on. I won't let that happen no more. About the thumb, you know.
Oh, we got Stallone on? Sylvester Stallone, welcome.
Yeah. Yo, it's good to be here, guys. You're doing a great job.
So Gazzo, the guy who hears everything, he asks Rocky who this girl he's going out with tomorrow night. Rocky, of course, wants to know, how do you know? A lot of canaries flying around on the docks. That line about the canaries was improvised by the great Joe Spinell.
Really?
Yeah. He was just supposed to say, you don't know, you don't think I hear things, you know, that what he said before. But to this point, the only people that knew that Rocky and Adrian were going to – well, only Rocky. Adrian doesn't even know yet. are Paulie –
get to that in a minute.
Paulie, Rocky, and possibly Andy the bartender because he overheard them. So who the hell is Gazzo talking to that heard that Rocky's going out with Adrian?
Well, maybe Paulie knew somebody. You know, maybe the guys, maybe somebody said something to somebody, right? Because Paulie set up the date, Paulie would know. And if someone has a big mouth, I would say Paulie would be the one with the big mouth.
Yeah, he'd be the candidate, absolutely.
Right. Adrian didn't even know Rocky was coming, so take her out of the mix. She could have told Gloria at the pet shop or something, right? But it wasn't her.
Ah, Gloria.
By the way, in the Rocky, the musical on Broadway, which was brilliant, there's a whole backstory with Gloria dating Paulie, and
really?
It's great. I'll tell you what, if you ever get the chance, I have it on DVD. Very hard to come by, but I went to New York. We saw it. We went backstage. We talked with Andy Carl, who played Rocky, and we were up in the dressing room. We met the whole cast of the show. It was fantastic. It was you got to be open to a little tweaks in the storyline. It's basically all the same, okay, as the original Rocky. But whatever they improved, I had no problem with. And I'm a purist. I'm a total purist.
Well, the plan for this project is to run through all the Rocky movies. As long as they want to make them, we're going to keep doing these podcasts.
Yeah.
But as kind of like little extras here and there, I wanted to do something like cover the play, which I've never seen and I want to see.
How would you cover it if you've never seen it?
Well, this is down the line. Right?
We
have 120 of these to get through first. we have a friend that we work with that absolutely despises the Rocky movie. So I kind of want to do a podcast with him to kind of get his argument to why Rocky stinks.
Jesus Christ.
Could you imagine?
No, I can't imagine.
I can't either.
That's like hating the character E.T. Nobody hates E.T. Everybody wants that little Adrian, that little alien to go home, right?
Little Adrian.
Yeah, I'm in Rocky mode. So, but I mean, like, how does he hate? Oh, that this is too insane, man.
Yeah, yeah. Tell me about it.
Wow.
He called it today. He called it a dumpster fire of a movie.
Okay.
That's a direct quote.
What, did his father drop him on his head as a kid or something?
That's the only reasonable explanation.
Maybe he had like poison or something as a kid. I don't know.
Drank bleach.
We're going to bring him on the show as a guest. We're going to have a show specifically for him to tell us why he hates Rocky. And then we're going to bring him on the Philadelphia Rocky tour to heckle you.
You know what?
Tell you why he hates your tour.
Oh, my God. I'm going to tape his eyes open with duct tape and have safety pins on the side so there's no way he can close his eyes. And we will Rocky him into submission.
Like Clockwork Orange. Right?
Exactly.
And we're going to see the Broadway show.
Oh, my God. No, he sounds like a great guy. Great guy.
All right. So so Mr. Gazzo is delighted that Rocky is going out with Paulie's sister. So is his driver. He says, now it's a little politically incorrect, and, you know, we don't want to offend anybody out there, but right. This was 1975, and this is the opinions of one man. Gazzo's driver says, "I hear she's retarded." And Rocky corrects him that she's not retarded, she's shy. And then driver Buddy says, "I'll tell you what to do. Take her to the zoo. I hear retards blank."
Oh my God.
He never gets to finish his quote. Well, he does, but not in this minute. "I hear retards blank," playing the match game again. Buddy is just an asshole.
Well, it's his prostate, man, you know.
Yeah, which we don't find out until next minute. All right, I mean, that's the end of the minute here, so.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm all tapped out notes-wise.
Well, fellas, if you don't mind, I'd like to come back tomorrow and finish chatting on this, if it's possible.
Let's see. We're going to have to move some guests around, but I think we could.
Tight schedule, but.
I think we can make room.
Yeah, we're ready.
Awesome.
In the meantime, why don't you let our fans know where they can find good old Mike Kunda?
Okay, so, if you want to look for Mike Kunda, you can find him at
damn it. Musculum Kunda.
You can find Mike Kunda at you can Google my website. It's the Yo Philly Rocky Film Tour. You can find me on Twitter. Just type in my name, Mike Kunda, K-U-N-D-A. I'm on Facebook. I'm all over the place. I'm like dog shit. I'm everywhere.
And catch him on the Slycast, too, with who else you got over there? Jeff Ferry?
Yeah, Craig and the two Jeffs. Yeah, and we got to get one of those going up soon. We have so much fun, but they're marathon sessions. They usually go 3.5 hours sometimes. So.
Wow, yeah. I've actually reached out to Craig a few times. We're trying to make it work, but he's busy. You know, it doesn't always work out. Well, plus, I think he's on the West Coast, right?
He is on the West Coast, and he works with one of the big I don't know if he's at Mandalay Bay or the Luxor. He's at one of those big places, and he's, like, in charge of all the entertainment. So he is a busy, busy dude, and he's a good guy. By the way, if I could just say one thing about Craig's voice, you guys listen to Howard Stern at all?
Used to.
Okay. Well, there's a guy on the Stern show, John Hine. He does the wrap-up show with Baba Booey. I swear to God, Craig sounds just like John Hine. He's got one of the best voices for radio.
Oh, excellent.
Anyways, that's my little bro love for the guy.
Yeah, yeah. Can't wait to get him on. We're going to make it work, I promise.
Nice.
Promise, Craig. All right, as for us, you can visit our Facebook listeners page, Mighty Mix. You can visit us on Twitter, at Rocky Minute. You can find us at duelinggenre.com with a ton of other good shows to listen to and some short films that Scott Corelli wrote and directed himself. You can yell at us on email, rockyminute@gmail.com. Swing by iTunes and give us a review. 5 stars, preferably. Until tomorrow, we'll talk to you on the next Rocky Minute.